The numbers are in and it is not good reading if you happen to be a woman. Data has revealed that 8 out of 10 UK companies apparently pay women less than men. Will the naming and shaming, as they've called it, make a difference, or is the gender pay gap here to stay? You're watching Roundtable with me, David Foster. What we've had presented is so far the most detailed study yet on the gender pay gap. UK companies forced to reveal who gets what. Are the figures as bad as they look for women, and will organisations take responsibility for change?
UK women are fired up and ready to fight for pay equality. And they have new information on their side. Companies in the UK have been forced to reveal their gender pay gap. The data is the most comprehensive ever gathered in any country. But will reporting actually reduce inequality? British Prime Minister Theresa May has vowed to tackle what she says is a burning injustice. It's now been revealed that 8 out of 10 companies in the UK pay women less than men. On average, men are paid 9.7% more than women. And according to the Office for National Statistics, the pay gap is as high as 18.4%.
It's still a man's world.
Some companies are doing worse than others. Budget airline Ryanair has one of the biggest pay differences, with men paid almost 75% more. The UK's National Health Service pays men an extra 23% despite employing more women. The finance and insurance sectors are the worst affected, but even those fighting for workers' rights have a pay problem. A trade union reported it paid its female workers almost 30% less than their male colleagues.
People need to look at statistics cautiously, though, because I think, you know, if you're just taking the average of a company, it doesn't give you a true view of where there is actually disparity in pay within the pay gaps.
But the public is being cautioned against taking the numbers too literally. Paying employees less for the same job has been illegal in the UK since the 70s Equal Pay Act. So why does it pay more to be a man? Traditional gender roles mean women put their careers on hold to have children. Fathers are less likely to take paid parental leave, and men fill more senior positions. One study found that mothers returning to work earn a third less than men in the UK. And if you're an ethnic woman, it's even worse. London's public workers face an ethnic pay gap of up to 37%. The naming and shaming has forced some publicly funded organisations to change. At the BBC, some men have taken pay cuts.
A few years ago, I did offer, and it was accepted, a pay cut. and more recently, I've voluntarily taken a very large pay cut.
Prime Minister Theresa May says transparency alone will not solve this problem and wants organisations to confront the issue head on. But does the government also need to provide more leadership? Will the numbers lead to widespread change? Will naming and shaming companies force them to look more closely at their responsibilities? Or will the fight to close the gender pay gap be a never-ending battle?
With me at the roundtable, we have Madeleine Grant, Digital Officer at the Institute of Economic Affairs, Dr. Shola Moshogbamimu, lawyer and founder of the Women in Leadership publication, who also organised London's Women's March. And we have Mike Buchanan, leader of the Justice for Men and Boys political party. I'm going to come to you in just a moment, because you are the Fight for Your Rights representative here, and you are, it's all a load of nonsense over there. But most interesting, Madeleine, here is that you represent your organisation, but you also represent your gender. And you have said, let me quote, "The conversation is misinformed because there's no evidence which suggests that women and men are being paid differently for the same jobs." That's the sort of wow from where I sit.
Well, I think that's what we have to look at. And I also think that that's what the general public are most interested in, whether men and women are being paid the same with the same credentials for comparable positions. But unfortunately, I think that the publication of this data is leading people to believe wrongly that men and women are being paid differently for doing the same work.
So are you saying, it's a straightforward question, this one, are you saying that men and women who do the same job are getting paid the same amount?
Well, yes, that's what happens if you start to break down the numbers. Right now, what they're doing is they are lumping all different types of workers. You're lumping receptionists in with CEOs, and you're not controlling for very important variables, things like age, experience, education, hours worked in the day, whether they've taken time out of the workforce for significant periods. And these are absolutely crucial determinants in setting pay. And I think to ignore them is to misinform the debate. And the reason I'm concerned as a young woman is that I think young women like me are being potentially fed a narrative that the cards are sort of stacked against them in the workforce, which just doesn't stack up.
And so that is a different argument. That is about the glass ceiling, isn't it? An opportunity as opposed to pay. All a load of nonsense. You're all getting paid the same amount of money, she says.
I don't think she's saying we're all getting paid the same amount of money.
For the same job. That's exactly what you're saying.
Yes, for the same job.
What I think is this. Now, I agree that the data is missing information in terms of, I want to see how much exactly men and women in the same position are getting paid, rather than the average earnings where you have people in a particular sector and it's kind of like, you know, a paintbrush that's been brushed over. Because that's not giving the exact detailed information that we need. However, I don't think that the lack of evidence, the lack of data, means that they're getting paid the same. I argue...
Well, just because there is no smoke doesn't mean there's not going to be any smoke or fire?
The fact that the lack of evidence, the absence of evidence, does not mean that what you are worried about is actually there.
So you are a lawyer.
Yes.
Lack of evidence is not good enough to prove a case.
No, lack of evidence means you should go get the evidence. It means somebody...
But we were told this was the evidence.
No. But the evidence does not have all of the information we require. The gender pay gap reporting is a good step. It's the first step, right, to ensuring there's accountability, to ensuring that society and organizations take that much needed step to addressing this gender inequality in pay. Now, we need to go a step further. I want to know exactly how much a man and a woman doing the same job in that organization are getting paid.
And what would happen if you found out it was the same? Would you walk away and say, okay, nothing to argue about anymore?
If we find out it's the same, we know that it's probably not going to be the same all
around.
We don't know. We do know, because there are many people who have shared their experiences to show that they know that people of the different gender are earning more than they are. Probably, of course, because, as we know from time immemorial, men have been put into more leadership positions and given far more opportunities than women. Mm. But the point is this. My issue, my question, is not about just the results coming out. It's what action are we going to take?
Okay.
How can we push the bar? How can we ensure we get the equality in place?
Yeah.
That is what we need to address.
The question I put to you, it was more like a statement, but it wasn't my statement. It was evidence
gender here. And I pointed out what I agree with her and what I don't agree.
Let's bring Mike in on this. I mean, do you think hearing what Maddie's just said backs up your case that this is all a load of nonsense?
It is. The IEA have been saying this for a long
time.
That's
who Maddie represents.
Yes.
Yeah.
The gender pay gap. If we look at the median hourly earnings of men and women, for part-time employees, the gender pay gap has been in favour of women for 20 years. It's currently, I think, around 9.1% or 9.5% for full-time workers.
Yeah, which is what we showed in our
exactly.
report. Yeah.
But the important point here, and is always missed, is that is pre-tax, that is gross pay. So that's, and when you actually look at post-tax, the gender pay gap is in favour of women by in recent years by about 2 or 3%. So, Shola, I've got to ask you, is the gender pay gap still a problem if it's in favour of women?
When you say it's in favour of women, you're talking particularly about the part-time.
I'm talking about full-time employees, mm-hmm. post-tax, the gender pay gap is in favour of women. And the reason for that is there are more men in the progressive tax, areas, so men pay more tax. Men actually pay about three-quarters of the tax.
Are we talking about proportionally? Or
exactly.
Are you talking about as a... at the end result that women get more in their pay packet. It's a strange old world, Mike, isn't it? If you get paid £20 and somebody gets paid £30, if you got the £20, you're ending up with more in your pocket than that person.
No, I don't agree with that interpretation.
No, I'm sorry, it's proportional.
But I can show you a paper by William Collins.
You can show me all the papers you like.
William Collins.
So facts don't matter.
No. There are facts and there are real facts. They're the facts of what women take home. They're the facts of the choices and no choices they have to make. They're the fact of what opportunities are given to women or are available to women. That is what we're talking about.
The median pay gap is in favour of women.
You know what?
William Collins, you quote, Mike, give me a second. He has also written about what he calls pay gap propaganda.
Yes.
In which he says it further reinforces the victimhood narrative for women, the purpose of which is to continually reconfirm the status of women as a deserving identity group. Well, I mean, that's strong stuff.
It's very strongly worded.
But I think his his argument seems to be that by sort of saying that we're not getting as much pay, or groups arguing about this all the time, when in fact the reality is much more blurred than that, then certain groups of women can say, hang on, we're being put upon.
Yeah, well, I think there are facts that young women should be told. So, for example, there's a negligible pay gap between women who never exit the workforce for a significant period of time and men. These are the kind of facts that people need to know, because I think that we are very much...
So if you stay in your job at the same time, one woman here, one man here, then it's going to be pretty much the same.
And so essentially for me, the outcome I want to see is equality of opportunity and free choices to be freely made. And I'm not sure at what point the government can do any more to re-engineer society so that women are making what they deem to be the right choices in, you know, perhaps going... not exiting the workforce for a significant period, spending more time at home with family, etc. I think there are many women who do want to make that choice, and I would hate to see a system where that choice is deemed less valid than the choice to remain.
So are you saying that there is no reason to pay a woman the same as a man if she's been away from the job for 3 years bringing up a young family and comes back to the same company? She should start at where she left.
Well, possibly, but you were not comparing her with herself. You're comparing her with the person who stayed in for those extra 3 years and gained that extra knowledge in that period of time.
Yeah, I suppose that's what I was trying to say, rather clumsily. And actually, it's
rather more than 3 years. There was a study out from the IFS earlier this year which examined the period of time when a couple is childless, and between that period and then until when their first child is age 20. And they found that during that period of time, the woman is on average likely to take around 10 years out of the workforce. I mean, of course, there's going to be some kind of penalty for that. How could there not be?
This should be a much more interesting discussion if I let you two talk to each other
rather than me jump in. I think the interesting variable there. I mean, look, I'm a professional myself, and I do recognize the the challenges when you take time off work and you come back in, especially if you've done maternity leave. The reality, though, is a lot of women out there, be them in the working class or middle class, don't necessarily feel that they have a choice. Because we know for a fact that a lot of women talk about that when they do earn and they have kids or family that they need to care for, most of their salary goes towards that. And there's also the argument that those who take time off to bring up family or bring up children or care for them, that they're actually contributing to society. Why isn't that value also recognized? Now, when they come back into the workplace, are they given the same opportunities? Now, we are only talking about one strand of women. Let's not forget the women who do work full-time, who also don't experience the same opportunities as their counterparts, and who are not getting paid
as much. But opportunities are different to pay. I know one.
No. But the
more opportunity may give you more pay.
Exactly. Opportunity results in pay. That's the bottom line in everything. Opportunity results in pay. So while a lot of women out there are pushing the bar, defying the barriers, and changing the stereotypes as much as they can, we do need the backing. We do need organisations to be far more conscious about ensuring that opportunity that can result in better pay all across the board.
It may seem odd if I ask this question of
Mike. It's probably going to be odd.
Thank you for that characterization. But I'm going to ask this question of Mike, and then you two can come in. Do women, in your opinion, have reason to be afraid of asking for a pay rise, which is one of the reasons put forward as to why they didn't get the recognition and therefore the pay they wanted or deserved?
No, they have no more reason than men.
What do you think?
Okay, so I don't think that answer is correct. Now, it's not about whether women have more cause to be afraid. It's not being afraid. That's not, the emphasis is on the wrong thing there. It is whether or not they are given the same platform. Women have been asking for more pay. I mean, the fact that maybe they're not as vocal, or they're not shouting down the office, or creating, you know, a storm, you know, about it. They've been asking for pay. A lot of them have, and most of them have not been getting it. You need to listen to the stories of those professional women out there.
But the reason
talking about it,
Shola, the reason I asked Mike that question is because he has represented a group which believes that women have more advantages in life than men and young boys. Well, not young boys, but young men and adult men.
More advantages. Do. Right. I mean, we do a
whole
lot more work.
The education system is skewed towards females, for a start.
Well, we women do, as Shola said, a lot more of the caring responsibilities, and including for relatives, where it's less obvious why it should be the daughter rather than the son of a family who is taking up that burden. And not just that, but there's plenty of evidence that men are less likely to do housework, even when the woman is the male breadwinner. Yeah. But these are really important conversations that I think need to take place, but they're not likely to be prompted by these gender reporting stats, which are so crude. There are these, and also, I'm not convinced that they can be solved through government intervention. These are kind of societal points, and actually I think an honest debate will allow us to ask those questions.
And Mike's
not had much to say recently.
I'd like to bring up the issue of work ethic. Dr. Catherine Hakim, a world-renowned sociologist, produced a paper on what she called preference theory in 2000, so nearly 20 years ago now. And her research showed that while 4 in 7 British men are work-centred, only 1 in 7 British women is work-centred.
That's perhaps because they have family responsibilities.
No, it's their orientation. We always hear from the 1 in 7 women who are work-centred. I mean, perhaps like you, Shola, or the Karen Bradys of this world, who want all women to be more work-centred. But at the end of the day, you know, women are autonomous, and they will, more than men, they will choose to do less work and have more of a better work-life balance.
Whereas for men
typically don't have that choice. And the reason they don't have that choice is that no woman will fund that choice, whereas plenty of men will fund women.
Can we relate this back to the gender pay gap? You're looking pretty furious at what he's just said.
All right, so I don't agree with that statement. First of all, when you talk about preference choice and women being work-centred, define the British woman to me. You define who a British woman is. You want to talk about work ethics? I would tell you this, there are a lot more women, especially women from the Black, Asian, minority ethnic groups. Not only do we work hard, we raise families, we run businesses, doing a number of things side by side. And it's not because a woman does not want to go to work. I've already explained to you, the reality is different from the academic facts written down. The bottom line is, if all that you earn is going to go towards a childminder, or all that you earn might end up only paying so much of your bills, at the end of the day, a lot of families and women who end up being the sole providers of their homes have to make a tough choice. And the tough choice is this: they do want to be ambitious, they want to get out there, they want to build their businesses or get into a career.
But the economic facts don't support some of your argument, which is an emotional argument rather than a financial one.
It is fact. We cannot.
Well, not according to Maddie.
We cannot ignore the choices and the circumstances that a number of women exist in, and how that influences their circumstances in the workplace and the pay they get.
Let's bring in Maddie at this point. Yeah.
I think we should always be looking at the choices made by individuals rather than attempting to categorise groups, whether, you know, work ethic or lack thereof. I'm not so concerned with that. What concerns me is, does every individual have the opportunity to make a free-made choice?
Yeah.
And I think that the gender pay gap reporting statistics that have come out today do absolutely nothing to further that. And there are ways in which they might actually create worse. Sorry.
You were probably about to say that, why it makes it worse.
Well, because I think it firstly could have a very demoralising effect on young women. And I also could see ways in which it could create perverse economic incentives for employers. So, for example, because it doesn't break down into pay quartiles very much, you've no
what
idea.
What does that mean?
So, sorry, and they don't factor in age. So what that means is that if you have a large group of people who are being paid supposedly lower amounts, we've no way of knowing if that is older women or it's simply that the company is hiring a larger share of young female graduates. Now, if it is the latter of those two things, they're actually, what do you expect employers to do? You can imagine a situation in which, because of these new measures, companies might be incentivized to hire fewer young female graduates, which worries me as a young woman.
Yeah, so why not have a system whereby not only would you be able to see what a company does in broadish terms, but one where you could go in and you could click on somebody from your department and see what the median salary was, the average salary was, and what it was for male and what it was for female in that bracket.
That's what we,
would that work?
I think that has to work. That has to be the next step. We need far more information than we have right now. Mm. And I'm still saying, and this is not just about the data, it's also about what people are saying. The gender out there, the women and the men, especially the women, what are they saying about what they're earning? What are they saying about the choices that they are left with? That's why I'm saying the gender pay gap does exist. To say it doesn't exist is hogwash.
Well, okay, Mike, so why not have a more open system where we could all find out what John is earning and what Jill is earning for their particular age group.
Not just age group, for that particular role.
I think a case could be made for that.
Goodness gracious, you all agree.
But I come back to the point that post-tax, the gender pay gap is in favour of women. And this is all about increasing women's incomes. So all that's going to happen is that the gender pay gap in favour of women is going to increase post-tax. I mean, and most of that.
No, but
tax,
by your very argument, if women ended up earning the same as men, then the tax they paid would be the same as men, and therefore they'd end up with the same amount,
but not more. Indeed, but at the moment, there's a huge tax gender gap. Men pay nearly three quarters of the tax in this country, income tax, and that goes to that
but
goes
you're
to women
comparing
as a class.
Apples and oranges.
Exactly.
No, but it goes to. I mean, that a lot of that far more money goes to women than it goes to men. So the gender pay gap, even at the gross level, all that money and more is going to the government. It's not in men's pockets.
You look totally confused by what
you're
saying.
I am rather confused. I mean, it's possibly more money is going to women, but I don't know the figures on this. I'll put my hands up and say. But I think it's very likely that women are spending more of that money on family expenditure than personal.
Let me quickly say that there's no more money going to women. Bottom line is this. When the government takes 40%, or you know whatever tax cut they're going to take, and you take your money home. If you're talking about more money going towards women, perhaps is it through benefits?
I don't want to get into this side of it. I really don't, because we don't have very much time.
Work. They take their take-home pay. There's no more money coming to women. If you earn more, you're going to pay more tax.
Do you want to answer your own question, or do you want me to ask you one which will give you an opportunity to say something else, or do I have to cut you off?
No, come on.
Okay, I suppose, as the Beatles say, you know, it's getting better all the time.
Absolutely.
Okay, so it is.
It needs to get better.
No, it is getting better.
It has to get better. I don't know if it's gotten better. I mean, these are the results just coming out. What we need to be asking is, what action are we going to take now? What we need to be looking at is, what story is this telling? What more? What questions can we ask? How much more can we push this further? That's what we need to be looking at.
Would you rather be a man or a woman in the workplace?
Oh, I am a woman all through, and I'm going to get what I need, be you man, woman. That is where I would rather be. I'm a woman, and I'll get the best
of what I need. Would you rather be a man or a woman in the workplace, Mike?
A man, certainly.
Okay, so you're both happy.
Would I rather be...
No, I'm not going to ask you the same question. I'm going to ask you where you think it goes from here.
Well, I don't necessarily think that it is better to be eliminating gaps for the sake of it if those gaps exist as a result of freely made choices. I just don't. And I think that there's plenty of evidence that in the countries that have taken the most drastic steps of all to reduce these differentials, that, for example, in Scandinavia, you still find that having given the most generous paternity and maternity leave, shared parental leave in the world, that still 90% of leave days are being used by women. So even in these countries that have tried to re-engineer society, they don't necessarily get the outcomes they want. So I think we just have to get out of this mindset of looking at...
No, we've got 2 minutes left. Do you think this is just a big PR exercise by the government that's sort of been forced into it by sort of vocal groups?
I think there is an element of that. I think that the Conservative government is trying to essentially appear a bit woke on this issue.
It's reactive rather than making.
Yes, and I have to say, I don't. When I hear members of the Women Equality Select Committee trying to defend the statistics, they don't do a particularly good job, because I think deep down they know that it is based on a lot of meaningless extrapolation.
Okay, there's another word for that, but quickly, you've got about 30 seconds each.
What's your question?
I haven't got one at this point.
What I would say is this. It's the gender pay results are the first step to us actually engaging society and organisations to driving change. But a lot more work needs to be done. We do need to end the propaganda and conversations around that the gender pay gap doesn't exist, or that the median, I don't know, is more in favor of women. We don't buy any of that. This is a problem that has existed way back from the time of the suffragettes. It's time for action, it's time to change, and this is how we can do it. Let's take those results and develop the right kind of action and tell the government what we need to have done.
Okay, Mike, I wish I had a chance to ask you a final question, but you're going to have to do that over a cup of tea in the back room, because we've got about 40 seconds until I have to say goodbye. Useful discussion, very quickly.
Yes. Very useful, but the gender pay gap is not a problem, therefore it doesn't require a solution.
There we go. Take that to the kitchen where you can have a cup of tea. Thank you all very, very much indeed. YouTube is where you can find us, as well as watching us online or on one of your satellite channels, YouTube Roundtable. You can see a whole host of different discussions on that, and we would love to hear your comments. We've heard their comments. We would love to hear your comments too, and pass on the message to all your friends. It's been a very, very open debate, and perhaps the most fascinating thing, apart from the fact that I've enjoyed all of your company, is the fact that, unbeknownst to you, we have a man from HR sitting in the corner there. I don't know whether it's because he wanted to hear about working practices or whether he just wanted 5 minutes away from the hothouse in there. But we'll be coming to you, Anil. Thanks very much indeed. OK, from me, David Foster, and the team, hope to have your company next time. Bye-bye.